restoration of the character is directly related to the restoration of life. Morally, you may say no. But theobiologically, that is the truth. Now, if you want to behave morally correct, then it can be a stress if you don't receive the true character of God. Without knowing the true character of God, you morally want to be correct, you morally want to be nice, then that can be a stress to you. The character of God, it's shown through Christ. And the law of God was shown, is shown in the law of God. And the character of God is shown in the law of God. And the character, so the character of Christ is the copy of the law of God. And the word of God, so therefore, word of God becomes our life. Now, when you look at the word, law of God, you feel terrified sometimes because there it says, stone someone to death. Is that the life character, the character which gives life? And that we become very confused. Yesterday at the prayer meeting, I showed you about this. I told you about this issue, first issue of the universe. Here in the Bible, we have petition of the righteous and avenge of the righteous. You know, Revelation, they said, how long did they have to wait until you avenge, okay, for our blood? You know, there is this Bible verse, Revelation chapter 6, around there. Yes, Revelation chapter 6. Let's look at Revelation chapter 6. Revelation chapter 6, verse 9. Okay. When the Lamb broke the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of all who had been martyred for the word of God and for being faithful in their testimony. Verse 10, they shouted to the Lord and said, "All sovereign Lord, holy and true, how long before you judge the people who belong to this world and avenge our blood for what they have done to us?" Revelation chapter 6, verse 9 and 10. If we translate, interpret this Bible verse in our way, is that those martyrs are the ones who receive the character of God? Now you read these Bible verses. Those people were martyred. And they say, what? God, why don't you kill those who killed us? Why don't you avenge for us? You know, when I studied the Revelation, I stopped at this point and I traveled for about a month. Because you see, martyrs, they are the ones who show the character of God in them. You know, one of the martyrs we know is the recent one is the Stephen. He was also a martyr. And Stephen says, you know, God, you know, Saul is stoning me to death. You know, even though I die, please avenge for me. Stephen didn't die in this way. Then what happened to this Revelation chapter 6, verse 9 and 10? How can you interpret this? 9 and 10. Now, when we interpret this Bible verse in our way of thinking, there's a how long before you judge the people who belong to this world and avenge our blood. So here, judge, what is that? So the judgment of God is the avenge? The judgment of avenge? So far, I have studied Revelation. You know, when I enter this denomination, I can accept all the prophetic events and instance. I can accept that. But according to the petition of the martyrs, let's read verse 11. You know, they ask this question, how long? You know, the question itself in verse 10, it's nonsense. As a martyr, you cannot ask this kind of question, how long before you judge the people who belong to this world and avenge your blood for what they have done to us? You know, this kind of martyrs, it's a problem. When Stephen died, when he was martyred, what did he pray? How did he pray? God, Lord, Saul, he doesn't know what he's doing now. Please forgive him. You know, Stephen died, but before he died, he prayed, God, remember Saul, he stoned me to death, so don't let him live. Is that what Stephen prayed when he died? According to this Bible verses, chapter 6, verse 9 and 10, it must be Stephen's prayer, but it wasn't. You know, me, I cannot accept that kind of interpretation in this Bible verse. Stephen, you know, before he died, in his prayer, I'm sure he might have prayed this way. Lord, Saul doesn't know who you are, and he doesn't know what he's doing now. Please send your Holy Spirit and enlighten him who truly you are. Use him to spread the true gospel, to spread the true character of God. Give him insight. You know, that must have been the prayer of Stephen. You know, Genesis chapter 4, the first martyr was Abel. Why was he killed? Why was he martyred? Abel was martyred because the character that Cain knew and the character that Abel knew, the character of God that Abel knew and the character of God that Abel knew were different. Abel knew that the character of God, for him, God is a giving God. He's a giver. By the blood of the Lamb, by the blood of the Jesus Christ, blood of Jesus Christ, Abel believed that will be saved by the blood of the Lamb, by the blood of Jesus Christ. But Cain, he believed that he should do something and he should offer something to God. You know, let's say Cain was the, you know, one of those elder, and then Abel also was one of those elders. Now, let's say in the Sabbath school, this elder Cain taught the salvation to be saved. You need to do something to God and give something to God. But then Abel, this elder Abel, he taught that our God is this kind of God and so. Remember, before the creation, before the sin, God already knew what was going to happen, and the plan was promised, which the Lamb of God is going to die was planned ahead. And in that plan, there was forgiveness unconditionally, and the righteousness by faith is included. And then remember Lucifer, it was not right with him. Satan, Lucifer said, every sin must be punished. But because of the mercy of God, he broke this righteousness. That's what the Satan said. And that's what Ellen G. White wrote in The Desire of Ages. I will show you. I will show you the right exact script. So, you know, Elder Cain's Sabbath school students and Elder Abel's Sabbath school students, they might have trouble. So those students say, well, our elder taught us this is the character of God. No, we don't have to do, you know, things, or we don't have to offer something because of the blood of the Lamb. We will be saved, and that's what our elder Abel taught us. Then let's say, you know, Elder Cain's students, let's say they want to go to Elder Cain's Sabbath school class because it sounds more beautiful. And then, of course, Elder Cain would feel, you know, bad because his students are leaving him. So this one, you know, they have different definition of the character of God. Cain and Abel, they had different ideas about the character of God. Genesis chapter 4, verse 8. Say here, one day Cain suggested to his brother. Well, we will read in a different version. Cain talked with Abel. Let's look at different version. Cain said to Abel, his brother, let's read another version of the Bible. Cain talked. I wanted to know what that means. Because I looked it up in the all the different versions, and they usually say talk. You know, talk, it's got to be something serious talk, serious conversation. And let's say, you know, I want to talk with you, means I want to have a deep conversation with you. In Hebrews, it's argument. In Hebrews, here, the word talk is argument. So this is, theologically, there was an argument. And then Cain thought, Abel, what you teach is different, is wrong. And it's heresy. According to the law of God, heresy should be stoned. So Cain thought what he did was very righteous because he followed the law of God. It's like Saul stoned Stephen to death. It's, you know, about the same. Here, stoned to death, that law of God, they misunderstood this law of God, stoning. Now, what does that mean, stoning? Here. Now, we heard this avenge. And the stoning. Can you find any character of God in that word, avenge or the stoning? How could Sister White write that stoning represents the character of Jesus Christ? How could she say? How did she understand these laws and the Bible verses? Many people can say that they are confused. Let's go back to the word avenge in Revelation. Revelation chapter 6, verse 9 and 10 that we have just read. And then 11 now. Verse 11. Then a white robe was given to each of them, and they're told to rest a little longer until the full number of their brothers and sisters, their fellow servants of Jesus, who are to be martyred, had joined them. I was like, well, number's not full yet. Please wait until the number is full. Until the number. Until they have the full number, wait. If this is what it means, if this interpretation is correct, I cannot take the character of Jesus Christ. Well, the words, they're all the character of Jesus Christ. So if you literally interpret in this way, you know, then you know what the rest of the Revelation means. This is about the bloody avenge book. This Revelation is the bloody avenge book. In that interpretation, can you find the character of Jesus Christ? I don't think so. All this time we learned that the character of God is life. Okay, everything is good. That we have to know the true character of God. What is His character then? You should know what is His character. Now we learn the character of God is life. And then you say, okay, let's have a beautiful character. If you stop in this level, then you reach only to the moral level of understanding. Now, verse 10 again. You find the word judge. Okay, you found the word judge. How long before you judge the people who belong to this word and avenge our blood? You know, I converted to Seventh-day Adventist, and I was in Presbyterian. You know, if you say, you know, avenge, okay, and so you'll be burned, and then you'll become the dust of the earth. So, you know, Presbyterians, they say we become, you know, go back to the earth. And then we say we'll be burned. Well, we'll be burned and we'll be like the dust. You know, different denominations says different ideas about the judgment, right? Some denomination, they say, we'll go back to the dust. Some denomination, they say, we'll suffer forever in the fire. Well, they're about the same. To me, they're about the same. Now, what is the true meaning of avenge biblically? Now, the reason why I think in this way, well, if you turn the Bible with me, Isaiah chapter 55, verse 8 and 9, here it says, "My thoughts are nothing like your thoughts, says the Lord, and my ways are far beyond anything you could imagine. For just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts are higher than your thoughts." So the meaning of the word avenge should be heaven and earth different. Our way of using the word avenge and the way God uses avenge should be different. If our way of interpretation is same with God, then our character is like God's character right now. But here it says, the Bible says, our way of thinking and God's way of thinking is totally different. There's a vast difference, heaven and earth difference. Then how is it different? We should know. You know, when God says to Cain, like, where is your brother Abel, and am I the brother keeper? And then God says there, in verse 10 in Genesis, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. What is the cry of the blood? What was the cry of Abel's blood? Excuse me. When Abel was dying, bleeding, Abel cried to God. That's the prayer. Abel prayed to God. Can you imagine what he prayed about? Oh Lord God, my brother is in big trouble, God. My brother, I thought he knew you, but he doesn't know you, God. Oh God, you have to enlighten him. Send him the Holy Spirit. You have to enlighten him. That's the cry of Abel. And that was the cry of Stephen when he was dying. Those who know the character of God, those who know Jesus Christ very well, they don't ask for revenge or revenge. Now those martyrs avenge, what is those martyrs avenge? You know, there is a vast difference, heaven and earth difference. We have been saying that the character of God is life, the character of God is life. But then if you don't understand the character, the true character of God, then you cannot give life to the patients, because you don't know the true character of God. Now Jesus said, eternal life is to know Jesus, the God, is to know God and Jesus Christ. So that's eternal life, right? So you should also understand the true meaning of avenge. So I looked it up to understand better or more about avenge. Let's find what Apostle Paul says about avenge in Romans. Romans 12, verse 17. Never pay back evil with more evil. The character has changed. Remember Paul? You know, Saul once, He was once Saul. I wonder how he converted, how he was converted. I think the essence of his conversion, the real reason that he was converted, I think, is, you know, when Stephen was stoned to death, he prayed. And when Stephen prayed, he said, God, Saul, you have to save him. You should let him know the true character of you. Let him have life. That love was for that enemy who was stoning him to death. That is the love of God. Isn't that the character of God? From there, that life, from that prayer, there was very strong light wave. And that was why Stephen's face was brightened. And I'm sure Saul saw that light in Stephen's face. How can it be like that? Well, Saul was thinking that he could have, like, very upset and angry about me. But then instead, Stephen, he radiated the light of God, and the image of Stephen's face was the image of Jesus Christ. And that Saul saw, and that touched Saul's heart. How can he forgive me? How can he have that kind of face looking at me unconditionally? Stephen was embracing every situation and every person who was stoning him. And then Saul saw that light and the image of God. And then Saul, that night, I'm sure he couldn't sleep, because every time he closed his eyes, Stephen's face came across. And he also saw the image of Jesus Christ praying for his own soul. Ah, so the God of Stephen was this kind of God. And I'm sure Saul was confused and he was struggling. Which God is the true God? Is that the God to stone those people? Is that the God who forgives? Which God is the true God? I'm sure Saul was troubled at that night. I'm sure he troubled. He stayed up all night thinking about it. He was about to go to Damascus next day, doing the same thing, doing the same job. He has to go there and stone people who believe in Jesus Christ. And there maybe he would meet, you know, second Stephen. Which God, whose God is the true God? I'm sure he must have troubled. You know, doctrines between two gods, they're the same doctrines. But the character was different between two gods. The character was different. Jehovah of Stephen and Jehovah of Paul were different. Stephen's Jehovah was Jesus Christ. So Saul didn't want to go to Damascus. He didn't want to go. But then, you know, pressure, there's a pressure. He has his own mission, right? So he had to go. But he was thinking this, maybe Stephen's God is the true God. The moment he chose to choose Stephen's God, the light shone to Saul. At that moment, I'm sure God sent him the light of love. When Paul chose to believe that, yeah, Stephen's God must be the true God. And then he heard this voice, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? That's the word of Jesus Christ. If I were, you know, speaking, I would say, hey, you bad person, why do you persecute me? But then I'm sure Saul heard this very loving voice, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Now, as he listened to this voice, you know, kind voice, he knew that he was forgiven. Oh, Lord, is that you, Lord? You know, Stephen, he finally, he avenged. That should be the avenge of Christians. If somebody stole your money, if somebody did really terrible things to you or your neighbor, you have to send him jail? You have to kill them? You have to send them hell? No, that can't be the true avenge. You have to let those people know the true character of God so that they accept Jesus Christ. Well, that is the spiritual avenge. That is not the earthly avenge. We should have the heavenly avenge, not the earthly avenge. Me, as I look at your face, I don't see you understood or you're touched. You know, when I talk about this to my patients, they cry. Is that Jesus Christ? Is that true Jesus Christ? And then, you know, they get healed. When the character, true character of Jesus Christ is shown, those patients, you know, they are touched and they cry and they accept Jesus Christ. At that moment, Saul fell, right? And the old Saul died. And the old Saul died. How did he die? Old Saul got stoned to death. What was the stone? The stone was Jesus Christ. So here, stone to stone, hear the word in it. There's a meaning of Jesus Christ, the character of Jesus Christ. Now Saul met this stone of Jesus Christ. Saul started to receive the life. You should know the true character of God, and then you know Jesus Christ. And then you know that eternal life is to know true God and Jesus Christ. To know the true character of God is eternal life. And I want to talk about this to you. If I say this in the beginning, you wouldn't listen to me. Theologians and pastors wouldn't listen to me if I, you know, start out to speak this in the beginning. But scientifically, now you cannot reject now. Now God, he really tried very hard to save Cain like he did with Saul. But Cain, he didn't know that God is life. And Cain is like, well, you punish me so much. Okay? He said, verse 13, it says, Cain said, my punishment is too great for me to bear. That's too much. He didn't get stoned by Jesus Christ, and he didn't die there. You know, why don't we introduce the character of God and the law of God in this way? This should be the foundation of Adventism. Then we know that the law of God is the character of Jesus Christ. We can witness this. Revelation, when you think about Revelation, sounds very scary many times. But these words, if these words represent the character of God, in the blessings, I say blessing is life. You know, there are 66 books in the Bible, but there is only one book in the Bible which says, those who read the word of this prophecy to the church, and he blesses all who listens to its message and obey what it says, for the time is near here. This book is the only book which blesses, which says it will bless those who read, will bless those who read the word of this prophecy. But we understand totally differently. That's why in chapter 3 in Revelation, Laodicean church, Jesus said, I am at the door and knock. Please put me, Jesus says, please put me in the law of God that you know. Please put me in the doctrines that you know. The doctrines and the laws of God. It's all about the character of God. And that's why Jesus is pounding now. He wants to be inside of the law. So if we understand the law of God, without the character of God, without the love of God, it is not right. When the latter rain comes, we will be surprised, very much surprised. You know, this scary book people call scary, you know, or scary book Revelation can be the life, okay, because it shows the true character of God. If you understand the true character of God, and then if you truly understand this Revelation, you will see the strong light, okay, powerful light of God, and you spread this gospel to people, and that should be our mission. You know, we keep the Sabbath, but if you don't know the true character or the real meaning of Sabbath, that it'll be just one of the rules. When the sun sets on Friday evening, now you understand that the life of God is filled with in the space and time on the Sabbath, and then you feel the breath of life, and you breathe the breath of life, and then you will be so sorry that the Sabbath is passing. When the sun goes down on Saturday, you will miss the breath of life. Ah, the Sabbath is going away, but you will have hope to meet another Sabbath coming. You need to have this kind of understandings of Sabbath. Isn't that the life with God and the walk with God? We have one more day to go, and we will focus on the character of God more. We have this concept and or definitions of avenge. I pray that this stoning or the avenge are changed.
(웃음) 심판이라는 그 자체가 무엇이냐를 제가 얘기를 안 했습니다.
I'm not saying, well, your question is like there is going to be no lake of fire then. That was your question. But I didn't even mention about the lake of fire and the judgment of God. Now, we don't get into this today. Now, before, but I talked about heavenly events and earthly events. What we know about the judgment or the righteousness, who is making this concept or definition of avenge or the judgment? Now, Satan's righteousness, for him, he said, whoever makes sin should be punished. That is Satan's righteousness. Is that wrong? No, that is correct. So we are confused in between Satan's righteousness and God's righteousness. Okay, let's get into this stoning. There's a lady, okay, Mary, who did committed adultery. They took her in front of Jesus. And those who got, you know, Pharisees and teachers, they held this stone to kill her. Now, which stone was that? Whose stone was that? That was the stone of death. They held the stone up and they asked the question to Jesus, according to the law of Moses, these kind of women should be stoned to death. What would you say? And they held this stone. That's the interpretation of the law. Now, Pharisees and the rabbis' interpretation of the law of God and the law of interpretation of Jesus Christ in the law of God, they're different. How did Jesus accept their challenge? If I were him, I would say, well, don't you know the heavenly stone and the earthly stone? You didn't read the book of Isaiah? Well, Jesus didn't do it. Jesus knew that their understandings, their interpretation of the law of God is wrong. He knew it, but he didn't respond to them directly. Instead, he stooped down and started to write. What did he write on the ground? What did he write on the ground? Well, Sister White said, Jesus wrote down their sins. What does that mean, he wrote down their sins? We interpret this morally. Well, in Sister White's, she understood sin in a different way that we do. So she wrote down their sins. Here, when she mentioned Jesus wrote down the sins, here sin means the misunderstanding of Jesus Christ. For example, let's say I wrote down Tom. Let's say wrote down Tom, so-and-so date, I saw you doing adultery. And then Tom would be surprised. Oh, he knows that I did this. And then Jake. You know, Do you think Jesus opened up their sins openly, publicly? I don't think that's the character of Jesus Christ. I don't think so. It is behavior orientated. If Jesus wrote down their sins, like in this way, it doesn't make sense. So I'm sure when Jesus wrote down their sins, I think he wrote down that those people around misunderstood the character of Jesus Christ and God. So, I can be wrong, but I think Jesus might have written this, like, I forgave David who did adultery with Bathsheba. And I forgave Samson who committed adultery with that prostitute. And those Pharisees and rabbis, teachers with the stone, they read that. That is correct. Yeah, David didn't die. He wasn't stoned to death. Samson wasn't stoned to death. Nobody stoned David to death but Nathan, prophet Nathan. If I were Nathan, you know, God told me to go to king. You know, God told me to go to king and say, you know, these things. It means what? It means what? The king will, you know, kill me. Okay? But then Nathan went to David, taking this risk. You know, Nathan took his risk, right? He took a chance. He might have killed by the king, but Nathan went there. And then Nathan told him this metaphor and this sheep, okay? And then, you know, David, you know, judged himself. And then Nathan said, that is you. And then David recognized that, you know, he committed a sin. And then when David said, and when David committed that he sinned, then Nathan said, God forgave you. And then David, he said, oh God, you forgave me. Now David, at the time, he was stoned by Jesus Christ, or of Jesus Christ. You know, stoning doesn't mean physically stoning, but there are a lot of Bible characters in, you know, there are a lot of Bible characters who are stoned. A lot of touching stories there. When we need to be stoned many times. We need this experience. So stone this woman, whoever has no sin. What does that mean? Those who didn't commit a sin, stone this woman. You shouldn't interpret this morally, okay? Well, you all have sinned, okay? You're all the same with this woman. It doesn't mean like that when Jesus said to people, those who has no sin, what does that mean? Who didn't sin? There's nobody who didn't commit a sin. But there can be one. I mean, there can be people around who has no sin. Who are those kind of people? Those who are stoned by Jesus Christ can be without sin. So when Jesus said, those who didn't sin, stone her. Means those who are stoned by Jesus Christ can stone. Because those people know what this true stone means. And the Pharisees and teachers and rabbis, they were speechless. So the stone that those rabbis and Pharisees hold, what, whose righteous was it? That was the righteousness of Satan. But the righteousness of God is to forgive those people and to save those people. Of course, that is up to this woman. That is up to this woman's choice, whether this woman accepts Jesus Christ or not. Of course, that's up to her choice. Anyways, everybody left. And then Jesus talks to this woman. Woman, is there anybody around who judge you? Only woman, this woman didn't run away because this woman knew that her life is here. She knew that this Jesus is the person that she was looking for. And she said, Lord, there's none around me. She said, none, Lord. And Jesus said, neither do I condemn you. Jesus said, neither do I. Now she was forgiven. And the old woman of herself got stoned to death, and the new daughter was born. That stone is the stone of life. When Jesus said, when God says, stone someone, that stone is life. So I'm sure the Spirit of God was poured down. I'm sure there are people who didn't receive the Spirit of God and stone people. But also, I'm sure there must be people who receive the Spirit of God when they stone people. And I'm sure those who are stoned to death might have received the Spirit of God. We shouldn't talk about these physical things only, but we should get into the spiritual level. Now, this woman, she was stoned by the true stone, which is Jesus Christ, and she was saved. She was delivered that day. After Jesus said, neither do I, Jesus said, go and sin no more. Does that mean if you sin again, then you won't be saved? Is that what it means? We morally interpret in this way. You know, when Jesus says, like, go and sin no more, when she sins, let's say when she sins next time, then who troubles more? Well, she will be troubled more because she had this experience, and of course God will, you know, be hurt because of this woman's sins again. So that's what it means. So we shouldn't interpret morally only. I pray that you understand the forgiveness of sin and the healing is directly, biologically, healing is directly related. When you preach with the life, with the Word of God and the true character of God, when you preach with the true character of God, you know, it will become the life to people. know, if you just preach that God forgave this one woman who committed adultery, you know, he's a good God. If you finish in this level, it is not life. Like I said, we have one more day to go. One more day to go. Pray. And I challenge you to challenge. You know, I challenged this at the camp meeting this summer, and there was not much trouble. Why? Because a lot of pastors, they were so busy, so they couldn't attend the camp meeting. But you know, it was taped and it was on the air, on the internet. And I didn't hear any problems. But anyways, please pray for yourself and for this class. I pray that you receive life from God. Let us pray. Loving Lord, please pour your Holy Spirit on us. We should know the true character of God. Please, Father, your remnant people, needs to know who Jesus Christ is. But you have told us in Revelation, we don't know you truly, Father. Please powerfully work on our heart. Please empower our genes so our genes will react to your powerful spirit. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.